John has requested that I talk a little about the B-17 that we fly. We're flying in, and how many missions. He knows how many missions. And to tell you the basic part of a B-17, I want to tell you the first thing, that it was a workhorse. Now, you're going to say, well, why did you put horse in there? Because if you get a good horse, he'll work you day in and day out and never complain. And that's what a B-17, of course, it couldn't talk to you, but it sure would give you a beautiful sound. A B-17 now is like, I'm going to give you some figures of what the length of the fuselage is and what the wingspan was. Now it won't be exactly the same, because I'd have to go downstairs and get nomenclature. But the B-17 was up possibly 100 feet from nose to tail. Wingspan was from tip to tip was like 70 feet. And it had four engines on it, and they were made by several companies. So I'm not going to mention any name which made the thing, because I don't want to give the company any notarization, because they had different engines on B-24s, they had different engines on the P-51s. Some of them were jet. Now, the ones on the B-17 were propeller engines. They were not jet engines. You would have to, when you went on a mission, the crew would have to pull these, the props were like in four blade, like a regular thing. And what you would have to do, you would have to pull each one of those propeller on the B-17 on each engine. You would have to pull that 12 times completely around. Each blade, you would pull it, and somebody would be standing back, and they would count the blades as they went around, and they would count how many you would do. You had to do that on all four engines. Now, what that did, that brought the oil back up into the cylinders of the engine. Could have been a Pratt Whitney or any one of those famous make names of the airplanes. And you did that, and of course, after you did each one of those 12 times, so if you're a good mathematician, that was 48 times that you pulled those props through. And what that was to bring the oil around and get all the ball bearings and everything in that engine, so that when you started, it was not starting at a dry point, like where you'd go out to start your car. Now, you normally will go out and start your car in the wintertime, and you'll turn the key on, and you'll let it run a little bit to bring that oil up into the pistons and the rings and stuff to get that. Oh, that's the area. I'll turn it off. And it's the same principle, that you don't want to start that thing up. What they do, and the reason why you do that is that because the pilot would pre-flight these engines on the ground at the hard stand is where it was parked, before you would take off, so that you didn't have any problems. And they would rev those engines up to 2,700 RPMs, each one of those engines. And I'll tell you, when he got to the number four engine, because he'd start number one, and he would do that to where he got up to 2,700 RPMs after we had pulled the props through. And then number two, he would do that, and number three, you know. And actually, the crew chiefs and stuff on the ground, which you always had a crew chief, and there was about four or five of the guys that worked on the plane before it took off and when it would come back, make sure if it had any damage, if the engine needed any work on it. So that's what they would do. They would put these big, we would call them chocks. They would put them under the tires in the front and the back. And then when that pilot would rev that engine up, that plane would start to want to go. What he had to do is that he had to put the flaps down, tail flaps and the wing flaps down, because that plane, if it didn't have those chocks on it, it would start moving, even though he had the brakes on, because that thing was ready to go leave that hard stand where it was parked to go taxi out to get on the runway. Now, he would pre-flight those engines, all four of them, in the hard stand. Then he would taxi out on this taxi strip to get onto the runway. Well, we didn't know what, it all depended on which way you were taking off on the runway, where you're going. I don't remember whether one was east and west or north and south. It didn't make any difference. Whichever end you run, they would taxi out, and then when they turned it to get onto the runway to take off, they would pre-flight those engines again to make sure they were all running just perfect. And if, say for instance, if you were doing that, and maybe one engine would hit an oil leak, and the other one maybe would just stop. So you're not going to take off. That mission's going to be aborted for that plane. So you go back and get in another plane. And so every plane that took off, which normally, basically, in takeoff, we'd try to take off 36 planes. It all depended on what mission you were going to and how many groups were going to fly. You might fly in 24, you might fly in 30, you might fly in 36, might fly in 48. We had four squadrons, 325th, 326th, 327th, and 407th. And you always was sure that there was going to be 30 to 36 planes which would go out of one of those squadrons. And there always was a stand-down squadron, which would be 407, it could be 325th, 26th, or 27th. But there was always 12 planes ready to take off if one of the other squadrons had a mishap or an abort. What they would do, they would take the, they wouldn't just put another plane into that 12 where they aborted that plane. That whole 12 didn't go. They moved in 407th or whatever squadron they wanted, and you would take off in the 36 or 30, whichever they wanted. I never took off in maybe just 12. It was always, you would try to make it where there was your units that rendezvoused up there, so you'd have 144 planes in. And then another group would do the same thing with 144, so then you'd be off to your target when you, after you rendezvoused, with 280 planes. But it was not all the time that you took 280 planes. It all depended on where you go. If you were just a small journey over into France before it was occupied by the United States and England, then you didn't go over there, and you had to, you had no station or no way to refuel again, or if you had a problem to land. So that was one of the good theories that the Air Force and the Army and them and the engineers all decided that when they got France, then they would make bases over there. But to keep the bases in England, north of London, you know, I don't recall whether they had any, they might have had fighter bases for fighters south of London, but all the stuff seemed to me being north of London, up over there and then over to the Wash, you know, where the Wash, where they would take you when you first came over there and school you and tell you that if you made 7 missions, you were lucky, you were safe. But if you had to make those 7, but that wasn't necessarily true. But that was from when the first came over there and started. Maybe they never made 7 missions. Maybe they only made 2 or 3 missions and then got shot down, because they said it was pretty close to have all the planes when they first started flying over there in December of 42, well, November and December 42, when they took off the planes. It was, if they took off, say, 20 planes or 18 planes or what, how many ever they took off, they were lucky sometimes to get 5 or 6 planes back, because the German Luftwaffe was a pretty top-notch air force in itself. But as it went on, and basically the Luftwaffe got knocked out of the sky from the fighters and probably some of the bomber gunners that knocked the planes down, which give everybody a chance to be on a playing field, which is what I like, to be on the same playing field. And it got to be that way. Of course, it got to be a little opposite after we knocked out the Luftwaffe and stuff. The missions got pretty good. But then the missions, I didn't worry about the fighter planes as much as I did flying through the anti-aircraft, which was where the projectile would come up and burst, and what we would call the steel, little bitty bits of the steel turned into what we would name as flak. And when that projectile would explode, it had smoke to it. And it wasn't white smoke, it was dark smoke. And then when that projectile exploded. Some of the smoke looked like little gremlins out there, little men. You've seen gremlins, I call, as a little odd creature. And of course, it was the gunner's ammunition, I mean, that he was shooting. And what the Germans were shooting up to us was much bigger than what we were. We go 50 caliber machine gun. It was very small to an 88 millimeter projectile. And when that thing would explode, it was a pretty good size.